And we're live on the page. Hello, everybody. This is Laura Isley with Full Circle Magic, and today we're going to be doing our live Q&A with Mr. Paul Gordon, our expert card magician. Everybody say hi to Paul.
Hi there.
Wish you could hear him clapping in the background, but we can't.
Hello,
we're
going to
start off with voted questions, and what we do is we ask our voted questions first to everybody, and then we'll be taking questions from the floor. And these questions are ones that everybody's voted on, so we'll go in line with what was voted first, what the most wanted question was,
okay.
And that's what your favorite strolling effect is. We have a lot of strolling magicians in our group. And so they wanted to know what your favorite strolling effect was.
Okay, well, I have a lot of strolling effects because most of the work I do is strolling. As a wedding entertainer, party entertainer, and a corporate entertainer, probably 70% of the work I do is standing. And my favorite effect is a trick of mine called Diminishing Not Likely. And I'll give you a brief outline of it. The pack of cards is shuffled, and the spectator chooses a card, goes back into the deck is shuffled, and you say, I need four helpers to locate your card. You take out four playing cards, and they all appear to be four duplicates of the card they chose to some humorous patter. And then the spectator is surprised, and they say, well, you can't have four, say, five of spades. And you say, well, I haven't. You snap your fingers, you turn them over, and you have the four aces, which is magical, and it leads you into a four-ace routine. That is one of my favorites. But I have so many, probably 20 or 30 at least, strolling effects that I use all the time.
That's fantastic. That I love that effect, actually, myself. That's great. Okay.
You can see a live clip of it on YouTube, on my web channel, on my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/user/PaulGordon. You can see all the live clips of a lot of performances of me doing these things live.
Oh, okay. Fantastic. Thank you for that link. James, if you will, our admin James is with us, and if you will go get that link and put it up for everybody, that would be great. And let me get to the next question here, because we have 21 questions, so we don't have a shortage.
Okay.
What everyday objects do you use in your strolling magic?
What everyday objects?
Yes.
Only a pack of cards.
Only a pack of cards.
Only a pack of cards and two or three packet tricks of mine, which I will change from time to time. But, you know, many, many years ago, back in the 70s, I met Peter Warlock, and I knew Peter Warlock fairly well. And he said to me, you know, young man, you can't only use cards. And to me, that comment was like a red rag to a bull. And I thought, well, why can't I? Let's try it. And so for the last 35 years or more, 40 years, I've been using just playing cards. And because it's the cards are the medium for good entertainment.
Oh, great. Okay, that's why I call you the card magician.
A card magician, that's right, and that's all I do. When I say that's all I do, it sounds belittling, doesn't it? But it is what I do, is entertain with a pack of cards. A, because I love it. B, because it's possible. And practically, or for practical reasons, it means I can go out nice and light. It's a cheap act.
The cheap act. That's like me as a mentalist. I can buy my entire stage show at an office supply, so I don't carry around a lot of effects, just some paper clips and whatnot. Does the size of one's hand really make a difference in learning sleights?
I don't believe so, but I have very small hands. I don't know if you can see that. They're very small hands. Not minute hands, but they're very small. So the only things I cannot do are sleights that require grips on the palm. So bottom deals, second deals, and certain passes I can't do because I don't have the ability to grip the deck properly. And
yeah,
Harry,
I have a hard time with that as well myself, which is one of the reasons why I don't do a lot of sleights.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm a firm believer, if you can't do a slight imperceptibly, there's no point in doing it. And there's probably not much point in practicing it, because if you don't have the physical ability, then you'll be wasting a lot of time trying to master it. Harry Lorraine and Jerry Andrus, I think, had small hands. And then you have the big hand guys like the late Larry Jennings, Ed Marlowe, and my friend Michael Vincent. You know, they've got big hands, so they can do a lot of those slights. But it's never stopped me. It's never worried me, because I compensate by doing other things.
Yeah, I've seen men that just have hands that swallow the pack of cards.
Well,
you have perfect hands for card handling, you know. And then you have the people you can tell that, like women especially, who have the smaller hands, and it's a lot more difficult to do certain effects. Even palming in mentalism with my hands, as small as it is, can get very difficult.
Interesting enough, if you look at, it's quite funny, the Card Cavalcade books by Jerry Mensah, he has such big hands that the pack of cards he's holding, it looks like he's holding a miniature deck. It really does. If you check the books out, it's quite funny.
I've seen people with hands like that that swallow a little deck. Our next question is about storytelling, and they want to know how important storytelling is in card magic.
I don't do storytelling, so I'm probably not the right person to ask on that. Because I'm a patter magician, I interact with the audience a lot, and I'm, again, you have to watch the live clips of me performing to see this, but I'm very cheeky with people, so I'm interacting with gags and impromptu bits of business. I would never have the time, especially in England. You know, the audiences, they require instant action, you know?
Yes.
Too long-winded is going to lose them over here.
I know. I find when people try and give me a card trick and they say, these four jacks went and robbed a bank, and this bank is now, you know, and here's your tell. And it feels remedial.
Yeah, it's very contrived, and it's, is not knocking it, but I find it, my wife will say this, she doesn't for a moment believe that the four jacks represent this, you know, so she's lost at the word go, you know.
Right.
To be snappy and working hard.
And now you're known for doing a lot of creations of your own and books and stuff. And the next question is, what is your creative process when you're creating an effect or a trick?
There's lots of processes. The first thing is that I'm very much a person who thinks outside the box, and I've been like that since I was a young boy. You know, when I was at school and the teachers would say, this is how you do it, I would often say, well, why can't I do it another way? You know, there must be another way of doing this, or, you know, I was constantly thinking about other things. So when it came to card magic, and the old masters, people like Charles Bertram, I think it was, would say, if you couldn't do the pass 60 times in 1 minute, you know, you're not worth your salt, or something like that anyway. And so I started coming up with other thoughts and ideas when I was very, very young. A lot of them are mathematical, because I believe that mathematical tricks are not dull. They're exciting if you make them exciting, and if you do them with pace and energy. So sometimes I'll think of an idea off the top of my head. Sometimes I'll think of a mathematical principle or use a mathematical principle and work effects around it, like I did with the 16th card books I wrote with Tom Craven, and explorations with Peter Duffy and John Rackabaumer, and Carbon Footprints, those kind of books. Some tricks will be ideas just literally come off the top of my head. Tricks of mine like Twister, for instance. I was just playing with the cards, had the idea, it came to fruition, wonderful. And then sometimes, which is the controversial time, where you see somebody else's trick and you think, maybe I could do that without the double backer, or I could do it without the setup, and you work out your way of doing it, and then you end up coming up with something totally new anyway. So there's lots of ways of coming up with ideas, but I think to be a knowledgeable card magician who can come up with ideas, you have to be a knowledgeable magician, in as much that this room that I'm sitting in, you can't see, but there's about 2,500 books on card magic in here, and that's a collection of books that I've been collecting for 40 years, and I've read every single one of them, back to front.
A few of them a couple of times, I imagine.
Yeah, I have, yeah. And I do, I devour them, I just love them, but I do read them back to front. I know a lot of magicians who own books, and they sit on the shelves, and they never read them. They buy them for the prettiness or whatever, or the fact that they can say, I've got that book. But like I say in my books, you'll never know how good a trick is or how bad it is until you read and try it.
Exactly. Exactly.
You'll never know, you know.
That being said, the next question following up that is, what is the strongest effect that you've ever created? I guess that the word strongest can mean many things, but I would take it as the most sold, the most popular, the most used effect that you've seen other magicians do that is the strongest one that you've created.
Yeah. It's a real tough one, that, because... I've written 38 books on magic in 25 years, and I've recently written two books, which are the best of, and those best of books contain nearly 300 tricks. As far as I'm concerned, they really are good. That's obviously for the reader to decide, but they are all tried and tested ones. So to pick strongest ones or most popular, it's so hard. The one I mentioned earlier, Diminishing Not Likely, tricks like Twister, Knock 'em Dead, Easy Ace Estimation. But on the packet trick front, I would say the best seller, and I know this because I've, over the years, over 20-odd years, I've had 5,000 of these printed, and they've nearly all gone, and that would be Corner of Piccadilly. And Corner of Piccadilly. You know it?
I've seen the YouTube video for it.
Yeah. It's very strong because it's a 3-4 card Monty trick. With a kicker ending, a kicker surprise ending, but it's all done with regular playing cards, so the cards can be examined. And that's a big stipulation when I create card tricks, that I don't care what happens in between, but you have to end clean as far as I'm concerned, because I know this is one of the questions somebody said, this is for the grabbers, you know?
Right, that was our next question, actually.
If you end clean and they grab... which they shouldn't grab, I'll come to that in a minute, but if they do grab and you end clean, we've got nothing to worry about. I'm looking now at my collection here, Corner of Piccadilly, Jeepers Creepers, Triple Kick Monty, The Ultimate Sting, The Red Herring, marketed tricks like that. They all have lots of surprises. The cards can be examined. You end clean. That's it. Does that help?
Yes, absolutely. I was just looking. I'm going to go ahead and take a couple of questions off the floor because we have a lot coming up on the floor as well.
Yeah.
I'm going to start back a little bit. FJ, I'll get to you in just a second. But James wanted to know who your inspiration was when starting out in magic. And you said you've been doing it for 40 years. So Who were your main inspirations starting out, and what got you into magic in the first place?
Well, I was good friends with Hofzinser. That's how long ago. I'm joking. I'm obviously joking. Hello, James, if you can see me. I suppose that those who know me know it's no secret that Harry Lorraine was the person who turned my life around when it came to magic, because when I was a young lad, I wanted to see all the greats, and... you know, I'm old enough to remember all the greats when they were around. So people like Ed Marlowe and Di Vernon. I just saw all of them, you know. And in this country, in England, Peter Kane and Walt Leese, and there's a whole stack of names. J.C. Wagner, a friend of mine as well. And it was J.C. Wagner and Harry Lorraine, really, that I saw that made me think, I want to do that. Because I'd seen people like Ed Marlowe fool the magicians and perform in a demonstration fashion, and that's not being critical of Ed Marlowe, but that's just the way I saw it. And I then saw Harry Lorraine in the other corner of this convention, and he was surrounded by about 200 people, and they were all laughing and smiling, and he had them held in the palm of his hand for about an hour. And I saw that, and I thought, one day I'd love to be able to do that, because that is thrilling. That is really thrilling. And it's up for others to try. But, yeah.
I said, that's what Tiki gets you.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's right. I mean, I've tried to do that myself, is to put so much energy into the act that my performance, I go up about 10 notches in pace and energy when I work. So it's, you know, those who have seen me perform live or on YouTube on the live clips will hopefully have seen that. But it's grabbing attention all the time. You know, you have to keep attention.
Yes, absolutely. And so you started performing at what age?
Well,
as performing for as a main source of income. Oh, you were very young.
Well, I tried it as a main source of income when I was 16 years old. I tried it, and I wasn't very good because I hadn't got the the age, the maturity. You know, I think when you're 16, people regard you as the kid. So I struggled a bit with that, but then I took it up again in my 30s. I'm now in my 50s. I took it up again in my 30s, early 30s.
You're young looking for somebody in their 50s.
Oh, bless you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a good surgeon. you know, I've forgotten the question now. Where were we?
A little compliment.
Me with a flattery.
We were on when you started performing for as an income.
Yeah, I was older than most, I guess, but I think I was a very shy and nervous, quiet teenager, and I didn't want to be. And again, this is Harry Lorraine outside of magic. My mother, rest her soul, she lent me a book called Secrets of Mind Power, which is all about how to deal with people, how to talk to people, and how to get a good personality. And so that was a great inspiration. And so I think I'd kind of got the hang of it all by my mid-20s. And, I've loved every minute of it.
Giovanni Arnold wanted to know, what do you think about card manipulation? And then he says, and Ha, Liam's Monster, 1980, Eduardo Galeano, etc.
Say that last bit again. Who?
Liam's Monster, 1980, comma, Eduardo Galeano, etc. I don't either. But what do you think about card manipulation? I guess that he means flourishes.
Flourishes. Yeah.
Do you do them when you perform at all?
I never do, no. Anybody listening here who's a flourisher into cardistry, I think is incredibly talented. It's very clever, far more technically skillful than I can ever possibly be. But to me, magic is supposed to be something that's hidden, something that's kind of inert, and then magical things happen. Whereas flourishes and cardistry are overt, and they then become a display of skill. A display of skill is juggling, and juggling isn't magic. Now, I don't mean to upset anybody by saying that. What I then did was, some years ago, because I obviously had upset people by saying that, I asked a bunch of flourishers who I met at a convention, I said to them, can I just ask you, why not try performing magic without the flourishes for the public, for laymen, and see if the response is greater or worse? And out of, I think we tested 20 people, and 10 of them wrote back to me or emailed me or phoned me saying that they actually agreed with me that they got better responses because they weren't displaying skill. The skill was something that seemed to be magical. Things magically happened. And that's it, really.
Yeah, that's actually something that you hear a lot from card magicians, is that they have two separate places.
Yeah.
In card magic, flourishes and
it's a different art form. It's a different art form, really. I mean, it's Funny enough, I just come back from the Blackpool convention. I have a dealer stand in Blackpool, big convention, and a young man came to my stand, and I was talking to him about this, and I said to him, I'm from the Di Vernon school of magic, that it's a naturalness. And he said to me, is Di Vernon going to be here at the convention?
I don't mean to laugh at that, since it hasn't been so long since he passed, but definitely not somebody that...
he obviously didn't know. So, you know, trying to say that to somebody young, you know, if they don't know who Di Vernon is, I think people should know who the greats are, because I think history is very important. I think it's good to know what came before, because it helps you in your own performance and your own understanding of magic.
We do find a lot of the younger magicians now that are skipping that part of learning magic. They're skipping the history of where it came from. And I'd really love for that to come back a lot more stronger. Alexander Parker says, hi, Paul.
Hello, Alexander.
Paul Ladd from the Lewis Club here saying, hi, Corner of Piccadilly is the one I hear of yours the most.
Yeah, and that's the one I mentioned earlier. That's the three-card, four-card Monty. I mean, Alexander, it's a strong trick, you know. It's if I could do it for you, I would do it for you right now, but I can't work out how to use technology like this and how to get close to the screen or far enough away from the screen. But as I say, go to YouTube.
It's
and you
tricky. let's see, Daniel saw, yep, from Workshop M8. And let's see, I'm going to go back to some of the voted questions now. Give me 1 second to get here.
We're still here, folks.
We're hanging in. We still have a lot of questions.
Whilst Laura's looking for the next question, I just want to say hello to everybody and thank you for tuning in. It's appreciated, because I'm a technophobe and I don't really understand what's happening here. I'm staring at a screen. Presumably there are people out there listening to me. And if you have taken up your time, thank you. And for all of you in England watching, thank you for not watching the football.
Oh, are we in the middle of a football
game? We're in the middle of a football match.
Well, there's a lot of viewers here, so we've... and imagine a lot of them are from the UK.
Yeah, that's nice.
That's nice that we're more important than the football. Then.
Yeah, well, we won't win the football anyway, because we have a really bad manager at the moment, so it doesn't matter.
Oh, no. Okay, next question. What is more important, the trick or the presentation, and how can you get that across?
Good question, whoever that one came from, or the people it came from. I'm very much of the mind that the trick should be clear-cut. The effect should be clear. So the effect is that this happens, that happens, end of story. And then the presentation, you know, I'm not in for storytelling like I mentioned earlier, but what I do is I have a very good idea of where I'm going with the effect and the presentation. I kind of know the basics, but mostly I'm ad-libbing with the audience. I'm joking with them. I'm making sure the trick comes across, but I think it's 80% presentation and performance and you yourself, because basically if for whatever reason they don't like you, it doesn't matter anyway. It's over. Frank Sinatra used to say, if you're indifferent, Ensville. And that's very true. If you don't grab them, if you don't get the attention, if they don't warm to you, if they don't like you, if they don't feel confident. And Laura, if I can mention this about confidence, not cockiness,
yes,
confidence, is know what you're going to do. Know the tricks inside out. Know the outs for each trick. What would happen if this goes wrong? How would I get out of it? Know the techniques and know what you're going to say and know what to say if the spectators interact or humor back with you. And I do that. I write down what would I say if they say this at that stage. And over the years, I've got a black book here in my drawer down here, full of lines that I've come up with or ones that I use. You know, my DVDs are full of these kind of jokes and little bits of business which will help you along. And maybe sometime in this question and answer, I can sort of tell you a few of them.
Oh, we'd love to hear now.
Oh, okay.
We're on the subject. Let's go for it.
Okay, let's go for it. Well, for instance, a lot of magicians ask me, how do you get into a group if you're doing strolling magic? How do you approach? I actually go up to a group and I say, you know, hello, folks, my name is Paul Gordon. I start shaking their hands. And by that stage, they know I'm friendly. And I take my cards out so they get an idea of what's going to happen here. I say, I'm here to entertain you. And I then start doing something. And because of the way I approach people, with I look them in the eye, I ask their names, I shake their hand, I think they like me. And because I'm a very strong believer in approaching people in the mode that they are in and in the style they are. Let me explain that. If you do a group of people in their 80s and 90s who are going to be slower because of their age, if you go in too fast, too quick, you're going to frighten them. So I need to bring my energy level down a bit. If you go to a bunch of teenagers who have had a few drinks, I then have to raise my energy and be a little bit snappier to approach them at their level. I'm hoping that makes sense.
Basically mirroring the people that you're going up to.
You said it perfectly, Laura. I'm mirroring what they're like. And then this also helps you with nerves because you are approaching a group in their realm. Now, if I go to a group and I feel there may be hostility, and there's normally only hostility with magicians because they've seen another magician who bore the bloody pants off them. That's really why. If I feel that, sometimes I go up at a wedding and I say, let's say the bride and groom are Tom and Mary. I'll go up to the group and say, hello folks, my name is Paul. I've been asked by Tom and Mary to come and entertain you with a little bit of magic. Now, that means the invitation comes from the bride and groom, and they're very unlikely then to say, clear off, because the bride and groom have asked me to come and see them. And if it's a corporate function, sometimes I'll say something like, oh, I've been asked by the MD, your managing director, Mr. Wilson, he's just asked me to come over and have a word with you. So therefore, it's an invitation, and they're not going to tell the MD to clear off either. You know, those are just a couple of things to suggest to get into a group.
That's a good little trick there.
I have plenty more lines, but we'd be here until 9 o'clock tomorrow night.
Okay, let's see. Let's go back to these questions here because we're in line. We've already done that one.
I can expand on these.
How to make healing tricks entertaining.
Aha. Well, I think, you know, I mentioned earlier, but if you've just come in on this, folks, dealing tricks get a bum rap. I think it's an Americanism. They get a bum rap because the assumption is because they are dealing and procedural, they are therefore boring. That is so far from the truth. I use a lot of dealing tricks, and excuse the modesty here, they are not boring because I do not make them boring. Now, for instance, when I deal cards, I don't look down. If you look down all the time when you're dealing cards, all people see are the top of your head. And if you continue to work down here, one day you'll look up and the audience will have gone home. You know, I joke about it, but it's true. So when I deal cards, I count silently in my head, and there's a system for doing that, which will take too long to explain here, but I can talk and count at the same time and interact with people. So if I need 10 cards, I can deal 10 cards quickly, I'm talking, and the trick is moving on. There's an effect of mine called shocked aces, which is a lot of people use it, I know, but it needs pace and energy. It's a very strong trick. 2 cards are chosen, and they go back in the deck, and with a small dealing procedure, you find the 4 aces, and as a kicker, you end up with the 2 cards that were chosen. And it's a self-working card trick. It's a dealing trick, but it's self-working. It's very easy to do. Shocked aces is just one of the many tricks in Gold Dust. Shameless plug. But it's very easy to do. It is dealing, but I think it's a persona and a personality thing. I have seen people perform dealing tricks so slowly that, you know, literally you could go and watch War and Peace or read War and Peace and come back and the guy would still be doing the dealing trick.
You've
got to be quick, in my opinion. And I am quick.
Brian Gutton wants you to know, Paul, I've been performing Cop Walk for 4 days at the NEC, and it's perfect for trade shows.
Ah, bless you. Thank you, Brian. That's very kind. It's a big favorite of mine. I don't do trade shows anymore, and if anybody's interested, I'll tell you later why. But I used to do trade shows all the time, and Cop Whacked is one of them because it's a jumbo trick, as Brian here knows. It's visual. There's a lot happening. It's only a few cards, so there's no thick packet going on here, but you get color-changing backs, you get changing faces, you get a lot happening, and it's all done up here towards the audience. And because the slights are minimal, they're easy to do slights to make the handling easier. Now, that's a trick that I created because I wanted to be able to do a trick up here facing the audience with jumbo cards. And you can also do the trick with the double jumbo, you know, the extra, whatever they're called, the supersized cards, uh-huh. because of the slights required. And it resets as well. So it's thank you, Brian, for those kind words.
And Daniel said great advice about the wedding fairs. Any advice for how to approach prospective clients?
Well, do you know what? I don't actually approach the clients. I kind of let them come to me, and then I tell them in some kind of way that their function would be hopeless without me.
Hopeless.
Well, I don't phrase it like that, obviously, but you know, there's a way of dealing with people that you actually get them to, you make them saliva with the thought that they want to book you. I suppose I did approach people and clients, you know, a long, long time ago, but hopefully with a good reputation, you know, they'll come to you. I'm a firm believer. If you do a party of 100 people, if you don't get at least 5 or 6 requests from people at that party to do their party, you're kind of doing something wrong. And that's normally, so you're performing in such a way that people saying, my God, if I have a party, I want that guy at my party. He must be there. And if they say that, you can then call the shots when it comes to the fee. You know, I don't argue with the fee. My fee is my fee, and if people book me, that's great. And if they don't, you can always find somebody cheaper, can't you? Always.
Absolutely. One little trick of mine when I'm doing to get referrals or to get bookings is I'll give a little incentive, maybe a gift or a small discount or something to the host of the party. For referrals
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Yeah.
James Snyder wanted to know, what is your favorite deck of playing cards to use on a daily basis, and how often do you switch out your cards during a gig or performance?
Hello, James. Thank you for the question. I don't have a favorite deck of playing cards, simply because the fact that I think it's good to use anything and everything and to practice with everything and everything. So when I'm at home, I have there's a shelf to my far right here with 20 different types of playing card about, and from day to day I change them for practice reasons. So to give you an idea, I use all manner of USPCC playing cards, you know, Tally-Ho, Bicycle, whatever. They're basically the same cut and the same design, the same fabric. I use English playing cards, Chinese playing cards, all sorts of playing cards, and I use bridge size, poker size, borderless cards with borders, so that if you're then in a situation where somebody throws you a pack of cards, you're not stymied and you're not stuck into a position where, oh, I've now got these cards, I can't therefore do that trick. So
I run into that problem quite a lot, actually.
Yeah, it's good to be able to work with any playing card. And I mean, ideally, okay, back to the question, ideally, in an ideal world, I used to like the original stud cards. The original stud cards. They're not the same anymore. But yet again, I have here, if I can just reach down, I've got, I think these originals. I bought, can you see that? Stud playing cards.
Uh-huh.
These are the original ones. They're perfectly cut. But if you buy them now, the actual deck itself is about, 3 millimeters thicker. so they've changed the stock on them, not as good as they used to be. That would be my ideal choice. And also, because I actually have a trick called stud, which is, let me just come back to that. Based on Harry Lorraine did a trick called Tally Ho, and because I use stud cards, I came up with a very fast dealing trick where you use the properties of the playing card case, and you end up with a royal flush on the table, as depicted by the picture of the royal flush on the card case. Hope that helps.
Okay. Now, this is a unusual question that maybe you can give this person some advice on. Paul Cochran says, "All right, Paul, I'm 17 years old and I gig occasionally. I perform predominantly card material. I would like to say I'm a confident person, but for some reason, when I handle cards, my hands tend to shake. I'm not actually sure where the problem lies. I'm not nervous, but they shake. I'd really like to fix this and know it looks uncomfortable to spectators. So do you have any advice or any tips for that?"
A large bottle of vodka, Paul.
A large bottle of vodka.
I'm joking. Well,
and it might actually work. A glass of wine before a performance. Young for that.
Yeah, no, don't do that. In fact, joking aside, you know, I enjoy a good drink when I'm not working, but I never drink, never ever drink when I'm performing or lecturing, because you start. I've seen a lot of magicians who end up relying on it, and they become almost kind of known as the drunk magicians, and it's not good. You lose your edge. If you start drinking, you lose that little sharp edge of performance, the adrenaline.
You lag.
But Paul, if your hands are shaking, you probably are nervous or apprehensive. And it comes back to, and this is quite a harsh advice to anybody, but it's not meant to be harsh, it's just meant to be blunt advice, is that normally magicians are nervous if one area of their whole magical being is uncertain, because again, to slightly reiterate and add to, you know, you have to know your onions, we say in England. You have to know your sleights perfectly, your patter, your presentation, how to deal with people, how to stand, how to dress, how to act, how to behave. There's so many aspects of being a good performer, and the only way you really get to lick that is to do it live. Now, when I was 13 or 14, my father said to me, instead of sitting around the house playing with the cards, I want you to go down to the local pub and entertain people. And I shook like a leaf, but I did it, and I was dreadful. I was really bad. I went back the second night after my father pushed me down there. The second night, I was really bad. The third night, etc., etc. After about a month of this, and the manager was beginning to get a bit wary, I started getting better, because I started to work harder at all these aspects of performance and understanding people and not barging into groups, knowing how to pull back when conversations start, and knowing how to take control so that conversations don't overrule your performance. So working in those arenas will probably help you, Paul. So if you have your ability to find somewhere local, and don't find somewhere that's polite. You need to find somewhere that's kind of rough and tumble, because performing for polite audiences and friends and family is not the same as working in a rough bar or a restaurant.
Oh, that's great advice. That's really great advice. How often do you practice? And does that make a big difference in performance?
Oh, it does. I mean, really practice for me now is actually at the actual performance. You know, when I'm doing shows, I'm kind of working so much that is the practice. But if I don't have a show for a few days or a week, which can happen in this day with the recession and so on, I start to feel rusty. So I have to run through a few tricks and a few moves on the way to a gig or the day before or something like that. So I'm always with the cards, but I'm not always with the cards. That's wrong. Because I have a life outside of it. You know, I go to conventions, and if I'm not working, you won't see me with a pack of cards. I go there to see old friends and that kind of thing. But I do practice, but yeah. But when I was young, I used to practice about 12 hours a day.
Yeah, I know people that you never see them without a deck of cards in their hands. They're always flipping through it and always manipulating them.
George, you know, that's an interesting point. Sadly, they're fiddling. A lot of them are fiddling, and that doesn't actually get you anywhere. You need to have studied rehearsal. The old phrase, practice makes perfect, isn't quite right. It's really perfect practice makes perfect.
That's one of my favorite sayings.
Yeah. So you
coach actually taught that to me when I was young. It's perfect
practice. So fiddling with playing cards doesn't really kind of get you anywhere. It probably just irritates other people. But you know, if you're going to practice, sit down and really work through the routines and the moves and the sleights. But again, I was actually quite fortunate because when I started, you know, say back in the late 60s and 70s, this is way before DVDs, videos, computers, and all that. There used to be two channels in this country on television, both in black and white, and they both used to be on for about 5 hours a day. So there was nothing much to do apart from playing games in the garden or sitting at home practicing card tricks for me. So I'm glad I was around before the distractions of modern day.
I know, it must be difficult with so many different avenues. Yeah. You know,
it's so easy to get distracted with your laptop or your PlayStation or your tablet or your mobile phone. 500 channels on TV, crazy.
And in that line of thought, how do you feel about YouTube? Is it beneficial or does it hurt the magic industry and so forth?
Well, I think that I don't want to sound like an old fuddy-duddy, but a lot of problems with modern technology is that YouTube has made magic too accessible, and it's made it too accessible to anybody who wants to expose tricks or perform them without permission or perform them badly, thereby exposing them. Now, I know somebody had made a derogatory comment about something I'd said about somebody performing on YouTube. But I have said to people beforehand, if you're going to put a trick on YouTube, you know, maybe at least get it right or at least work harder on it for your own benefit, really, because everybody's watching you perform badly. The only person who's getting a bad reputation is you yourself. So why not go the extra mile, the extra yard, and try harder? Because you've got the ability, I mean, especially with videos, you can retake and retake and retake and practice and practice and practice and get it right. It's got to be beneficial for yourself.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I still, you know, am from the era, too. I'm in my 50s, and I learned.
You look beautiful as well.
Thank you. But I learned from library books.
Yeah.
And I tend to think that people that watch some of these YouTube videos and the ones that are done poorly and some of the reveals that aren't even done properly,
yeah,
and then they learn an improper way of doing something or they copy an improper move,
yeah,
and it's hard to break. Whereas if you learn from a book, you're creating your own move.
Well, that's exactly it. I say, you know, in my books, especially Gold Dust and Gold Dust Companion, I say, here are the nuts and bolts. You need to find your own way, your own persona, your own style, your own pace and energy. You know, nobody can be me. I can't be you. So we have to find our own direction. And the trouble is you know, I said this many, many years ago. You know, I've been lecturing for a long, long time, and 25 years. And I said a long, long time ago, I'd noticed in the late 70s when I was a young lad that the first videos that came out, in my recollection of this, were the Stevens Magic videos, and the Slidini one was very popular. Mm-hmm. And the next year, at one of the conventions in England, there were a lot of 12-year-old white English boys walking around saying this, "Hey, your watch, I take the coin. I vanish the coin." And they were all doing impersonations of Slidini. And that was the first time that anybody had noticed this kind of thing happening, because if you watch somebody purely on a DVD, even if you don't want to, by osmosis, by the mere fact you're watching them, you can start mimicking their style.
Exactly.
But if you read a book, you have no idea really of the person's actual vocal intonation. And if you like the trick and you can understand it and you work it, you'll find your own way in life.
I agree, absolutely. The next question here is, how did you come to release your effects with Christian Schenk at Card Shark?
Well, I've only actually released one effect with him, I think. And that wasn't an exclusive. That was because the Corner of Piccadilly, again, I used to sell it with antique... It looks good with antique playing cards. That's the hub of the presentation. And I used to sell them with antique playing cards I sourced in this country. And then when Christian came out with his antique playing cards, his vintage cards, I got in contact with him. And A, I purchased the cards, and B, he then sold it via his outlets as well. Fantastic quality cards.
Fantastic. Paul Fleming wanted to think it was important to let you know that England went ahead and scored. England has scored.
They have scored. You're kidding.
They have scored.
Really?
No, England scored, yes.
For that. My God. Who told me that?
Paul Fleming.
Ah, Paul Fleming. Hello, Paul.
Daniel Saul wants to know, how do you stay fresh? I mean, you must perform the same material over and over again. Do you approach it differently every time, or do you have a way of entering a performance mindset? Or is it just a natural by now?
To stay fresh, I use wet wipes. well, actually, now this is my outside of magic, another hero of mine is Frank Sinatra. And I saw Frank Sinatra perform 18 times in concert over a 15-year period. And I also am well known outside of magic as a major authority on Frank Sinatra music, and I have thousands of videos of him in concert over a 50-year period. Anyway,
wow.
That is that every time he sang a song, he made it look like he was singing it for the very first time, trying to impress a new agent on the front row. I mean, for instance, My Way, every time he sang My Way, he must have sang it thousands of times, but he made it look fresh by enthusiasm. Now, when I perform, I am incredibly enthusiastic because I love what I do, and I'm not tired with the tricks. I do them, as you mentioned, it's as your reader mentioned, thousands of times. I mean, probably on a gig. If I'm doing a gig for, say, 2 hours and I'm doing a strolling gig for groups of four, I probably do the same set 40, 50 times maybe. And if I'm doing that 4 or 5 times a week or whatever it may be, that's a lot of performing of the same tricks. And I, because I'm enthusiastic and I love it, I don't get tired of it. And I'm enthusiastic.
That's enthusiasm. It makes a big difference. If you're tired of performing the same things over and over again and you look tired when you're doing it, then it's not going to be fresh. You know,
it's up
to presentation a lot.
Enthusiasm is infectious.
Absolutely.
As a performer,
this next question kind of goes along with that because he wants to know how important is your voice in performance and do you train it at all? I think vocal inflection is absolutely important in performance.
Absolutely. And do you know who asked that question?
Daniel again. Daniel Saul. It's kind of like a two-part question.
Oh, Daniel. Hello, Daniel. It's a very good question, and Walt Leese, editor of ABRA, a very famous English magician, a very good English magician, he very kindly wrote that Paul Gordon has very good diction and is very clearly understood anywhere in the room. Now, it didn't come by pure chance. I have worked on it over the years. I have a very southern English accent anyway. I don't have a particular accent. It's called a Sussex voice, which is almost accentless, although I'm English.
I was going to say, it sounds...
but it's also, as a hobby, for 20-odd years, I've sung in a big band. I'm a big band singer.
Fantastic.
Yeah, and so I have good pipes, I have good breath control, and I'm always aware that, and I'm trying not to do it now, how many performers and ah, or, you know, stutter or mumble their words or look down when they're talking, or they'll say a funny line, and because they're not confident with it, they taper off at the end. So I think it's very important to almost know what you're saying a moment before you say it. You know, all professional speakers do that. They don't just ramble off. They actually are kind of thinking momentarily before they speak so that you don't come out with a load of nonsense.
Yeah, thinking before you speak is sometimes it'll make somebody pause too, and you have to watch your pauses because they can make the performance lag. So when you pause, so does the spectator.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose I have to be careful how I say this, and this is just meant on a speaking point of view, but a certain German dictator was a fantastic speaker. And there's a lot to be learned by the vocal intonation and the pauses. A lot of performers, although I talk quickly and I talk fast and with a lot of energy, I do know how to pause and let the story flow, I think.
And yeah, if you put your pauses in the correct spot, it's right. But if you put your pauses in the wrong spot, if you pause in the middle of a sentence, or if you pause in the middle of an effect at the wrong spot, it can really mess up the
presentation.
Let me ask this. When you're going from table to table, say you're at a wedding, and you're going from table to table, how many different effects do you perform in one night? Are you performing the same effect or the same trick from table to table? Are you switching it up a lot so people aren't seeing the same thing?
A good question is, because if I do a party of 300 people, and I'm doing 2 hours, I kind of divide it up into, I probably need to do 5 minutes per table. So if I'm doing 5 minutes per table, for me, that's probably about six or seven tricks. That's how fast I work. I will do the same stuff basically at every table. But I also then have a backup of various effects that I'll do later if I meet the same people in the bar or sitting in the hallway or something like that. Now, my favorite kind of function to do, and I do a lot of these and I love them dearly, is if somebody invites me to their house to do a house party for, say, five people for 1 hour. What that means is I sit around their dining room table for 1 hour and I start with good energy and I end up with even better energy because, you know, you've got to keep their attention for an hour. But I'm actually doing completely different tricks, which means I'm doing probably, I worked it out once, the most I've done from start to finish is 60 effects. That's a lot. And it's also because I have a trained memory. Again, I learned the Harry Lorraine course, so I'm good with memory. I remember people's names. I'm not boasting here, but a lot of people have seen me do this. If I do a wedding of 300 people, I remember everybody. I remember all their names. Absolutely true. So when I go back to them again 1 hour later or 2 hours later, I can say, "Hello, Charlie. Nice to see you, Phil. How are you doing, Pam? I'm back again."
Very impressive.
They like you for that, and you become even more approachable and more friendly, and you get the one phrase I hear mostly at magic conventions, which drives me crazy, is where the magician will say to the spectator, they come up and help them at the table, they ask them their name, and then about 10 seconds later they say the deathless phrase, "What was your name again?"
Oh.
Drives me crazy, that. Because if you can't be bothered to remember that person's name in the first place, it's really bad. And you've alienated that person. There's at least one person who doesn't like you, because the most important thing to all of us is us. We want to be remembered. We don't want people to saying, "What's your name again?" and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, I highly recommend to magicians, you know, go on business courses, go on memory courses, just not just magic, go on performance courses or read about it, and so on, you know.
Right, absolutely. On that line, what books do you recommend for beginner and intermediate card magicians to help with their performance and their card magic?
Am I allowed to mention my own work here?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. Well, outside of my own work, I recommend Harry Lorraine's Secrets of Mind Power. Secrets of Mind Power. It's not memory. It's all about personality, character, nerves, etc., etc. Fantastic book. It's the one my mother recommended to me 40 years ago. Secondly, I recommend one of Harry Lorraine's memory books, because that will help you remember the tricks and remember people. Thirdly, I can't think of a title offhand, but I get a good book on business and performance. Trick-wise, beginner's books, you can't beat the raw road to card magic when it comes to card magic. I still think it's fantastic. Harry Lorraine's Close-Up Card Magic is still a favorite. And I wrote a book, it's out of print now, but it's available on library.com. It's called The Real Secrets of Card Magic. And The Real Secrets of Card Magic is basically what I'm telling you here this evening and a lot more. It's all about nerves, presentation, patter, what to say, what not to say, how to approach groups, how to get business, how to get work, how to set your fees, how to stand, how to talk, all the aspects of performing good card magic, in my humble opinion, are in that book. It's a PDF. I think it's about $10, as you would say in America.
I love library.com. I get a lot of things at library.com. It's very affordable, and it's
a lot of stuff on there. Well, I've got, I think I have 10 titles on there. The Real Secrets of Card Magic is if anybody wanting to start out in this racket, and I do call it a racket, by the way, fondly I call it a racket, is to look at that. And also, shameless plug, but these are my babies here. Can you see that? This is
yes.
Gold Dust and Gold Dust Companion. They're
I've actually put them up on the thread.
Oh, you've done that, have you?
Yeah, I've put them up for you.
I'm staring between the books here. This is the best of everything I've ever done, and there's a lot of new stuff in here as well, but it's all been rewritten from the old days. All the old tricks have been added to, extra nuances, new presentations, all the things that happen over the years, new illustrations, new photographs. There's about 40 new tricks in there, or tricks I never wanted to release, but I thought I better before I get too old. But they're cloth-bound, beautifully produced, and there's 270 routines in there, and every single one, I promise you, is a worker. Whether you work in trade shows, close-up, standing, strolling, at tables, big, small, strolling tricks, everything you can think of in there, 90% with a regular deck, and the ones that aren't with a regular deck are packet tricks that you will end clean with. So that's Gold Dust and Gold Dust Companion, 270 routines in there, folks. So, and they've got some great reviews all over the place. Go to my website. If I can just tell you this, it's paulgordon.net/golddust.html. Hope you pick that up.
Yes, absolutely. Put that up, fact. Let me see.
paulgordon.net. Follow the links. Yep.
paulgordon.net/golddust.html. Got it. It is up on the thread.
Thank you very much.
No problem.
Oh, and everybody watching, there's about 20 tricks performed, you know, demonstration videos on that page for you to look at some of the tricks.
Oh my God, England won.
No.
Yes.
My God.
No, England won. Goodness. You're being updated.
I nearly fell off my chair.
England won. And you said, oh, we won't win.
See, I can't do predictions.
I should have predicted you would at the beginning.
Yeah.
Would have been good for my career. Okay, let's see. What's the next question?
Folks, ask anything you want.
How important is it for you? Wait a minute. How important is it for you to routine a performance and segue from one trick to the next?
Very good question. Can I ask who from?
Ronald St. Pierre from Japan.
Hello, Ronald St. Pierre from Japan. I never have a set routine. What I do have are a whole bunch of tricks in this strange filing system in my head. So the routines that I use, and out of the gold dust books I've just told you there, of course I don't remember all of them all the time, but I have used all of them all the time at one stage or another, and will use them again. But I normally have about 60 tricks up here, and depending on the comments people say, I might then segue into that particular trick. For instance, a favorite trick of mine, which Harry Lorraine likes so much, he put it in one of his books, is Paul Gordon's head-to-head poker. It's a very easy trick to do, but it packs a wallop, it really does. And I only do it if somebody says, I wouldn't want to play cards with you.
Uh-huh.
If they say that, I then do the trick. So I have certain tricks I reserve for those moments when people say certain comments. So although I know kind of where I'm going, I like to be able to go off at tangents and round off the routine. So I don't have any set act. Never had a set act. And I think the problem with set acts is, in my opinion, and this is not to offend anyone who has a set act, but if you're rigid to performance, trick-wise and patter-wise, it doesn't leave you any room for unexpected moments of interaction from the audience. And I've seen some very well-known card magicians who, if somebody comes in with a comment, they kind of freeze, they don't know how to interact, they wait until the person stops talking, who then feels embarrassed, and then they have to kind of look through their script and then get back into where they were. It looks very embarrassing, I think.
Yeah, it looks very set.
It looks a bit...
It doesn't flow.
Yeah, yeah.
So segueing from one trick to another is basically easy for you because you have such a large menagerie of tricks in your head already.
You have a good repertoire of routines. And also, most of my routines, the biggest setup is four cards. And I don't cull cards. What I do is I actually set them as I'm talking. I literally, during the applause of the trick prior, I kind of get myself into position during the applause as quick as this, and I can go into the next one. And sometimes, I'll give you, for instance, let's say I go, somebody shuffles the cards, and I always have a quick look through. If I see, say, three aces together, I'll quickly get the next ace into position and then do a four-ace trick.
So you're setting while they're clapping.
I'm setting while I'm actually taking advantage of if they've shuffled the cards a certain way. So I'm really winging it. It's kind of jazz performance, I think you'd call it. I'm like a jazz performer.
And how many decks do you go through again in one gig? Do you...
probably one, I think.
Just holding the same deck from table to table?
Yeah, I take a spare deck just in case, because once somebody dropped the pack of cards and half the cards fell into a pint of beer.
Yeah. So, backup for that.
Backup for that occasion.
David Abel wants to know if you have a favorite opening and closing effect.
Hello, David. I know David. He's a lovely chap. And... I shall be seeing him at Card... By the way, Card Capers. Anybody who wants to come to Card Capers, the next one's on the 6th of April, where I do a whole day of tuition. It's great fun, and I can tell all the stories and the jokes I can't tell live. there's a lot of stuff that I can't tell you here. But he asked a favourite opening and a favourite closer.
Yes.
Well, again, I don't really have a favourite. I normally open, well, there's a trick of mine called the world's best card trick, which is not my trick at all. It's my presentation, and it's too complicated to explain the whole thing right now. It takes too long to describe it, but it's a you can see it on my website. But I'll tell you what, I normally end either with my ace cutting, easy ace estimation, or as a kicker after that, I sometimes end with the original Paul Curry Out of This World, and I do it from a shuffled deck of cards. Shuffled deck.
Daniel wants to know where the card capers is going to be.
Sorry.
Where?
Card capers is in Worthing, where I live. It's on the south coast, and we have magicians. I have magicians come from the Netherlands and Canada, France, and all over. Magicians are all over come to it. It's a whole day on the Sunday, 6th of April, and there's a lot of energy, all the gags, all the stories, as many tricks as we can get in. The beer is flowing, the food is free, and it's a lot of fun.
Sounds fantastic.
And a lot of dancing girls as well.
A lot of dancing girls as well. Did you hear that, Daniel? He says, the famous beer deck. I want to come up with a routine for that. How do you cope with performing in hot weather when you have clammy hands?
Very good question. Very difficult. I learned a long time ago not to keep the cards in my hand for too long. And if I do, I'll demonstrate. A lot of magicians walk around from table to table. Can you see that? They
yes.
hold it like that. And if it's hot, you end up with the top three or four cards and the bottom three or four cards buckled. Now, when I go from table to table, I know it's a pain in the neck, but I put the cards back in the card case for as long as possible. But then sometimes what I'll do is, if there's not enough time to do that, I hold the cards like this from table to table. Can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just a easy picture. And if it's too hot, I try and put my packet tricks back in the in my jacket, which is drier than my shirt pocket.
Right, it's not against your body.
So there's nothing worse than working with a pack of cards that have got buckled. A heat crimp is what they call it. It's really difficult because I do a lot of Faro shuffle work professionally.
Now, I was going to ask you what your favorite shuffle and what your favorite stack. You use a stack deck at all at any point?
I don't use a stack deck at all because I'm always working. They want to shuffle the cards, I let them. You know, the freer you are with the props that you handle, the less they will want to grab them. I noticed there was a question about grabbers. And
we touched on that a little bit earlier. Somebody wants to know what you do about grabbers.
Well, if you've got good audience control, they won't grab. If you handle, and I can't describe this in the short time we've got here, but if you know how to handle an audience, they won't want to grab because you are in control and you are the performer and you have set a stage that you are doing what you're doing and people don't grab cards. But again, like I said earlier, if they do grab, if there are grabbers there, make sure that the packet tricks, for instance, are examinable. I know quite a lot of very good packet tricks out there which are fantastic to do for friends and family in the magic club, but they're not very good professionally because you're left with so much dirt on the table. And if you're left on the table with double faces and double backers, I don't think it's very good. So all the packet tricks I sell, and the packet tricks are in the Gold Dust books, they are all examinable at the end. And
That's fantastic.
And also,
I know you had said you do, 6 to 7 effects per table, 6 to 7 tricks per table?
Yeah.
Terry Solomon wanted to know how long you spend at each table while strolling or hopping.
Is that Terry, was that?
So, Perry Salmon.
Perry Salmon.
Yes.
Hello, Perry.
Yes.
Well, it depends on how long I'm doing and how many tables. So, you know, if I'm doing 2 hours, I don't do more than 2 hours, by the way, because I work so hard. I really do. I'm so energetic when I work. I'm shattered at the end of it. You know, maybe when I was younger I could have done longer, but I do 2 hours maximum, and I never take a break. This is something, by the way, on a segue to your question, I know a lot of performers who disappear to reset, they disappear to have a drink and they disappear to grab a sausage roll. I really don't. I work constantly for 2 hours. I don't reset at all. And I've worked out that if you're doing 20 tables and it takes you 2 or 3 minutes to reset between each table, that's nearly 1 hour of resetting. As a professional performer, you've got 1 hour where your colleague, if you're working with two magicians, he's spending 1 hour resetting or eating sausage rolls or drinking water.
It's kind of a waste of the host's money.
Yeah, and it's doesn't. I don't think it looks very professional if you keep disappearing. So my act is there's nothing to reset. I just put it back in and I'm ready to go again.
Do you you had mentioned early in your career you started doing practicing and doing your work at pubs.
Yeah.
So are you very familiar with doing restaurant magic and hopping from table to table? What do you do when people are eating? Do you wait for them to finish their plates and go up afterwards, or how do you deal with performing for people that are eating?
Well, first, just to start that, a reply to that, is that for a long time I used to work behind a bar, doing tricks from behind the bar. That was one of the things I used to do. So I had the people come up to see me in a restaurant or in a club or in a pub. And I actually used to serve the drinks as well. So I'd be pouring drinks and serving from the optics, calculating the bill whilst spreading the cards on the bar top, asking them to choose cards. a bit like J.C. Wagner, but I was also serving the drinks. But going from table to table in restaurants, I've never liked it much because they are eating so much. It's very hard to get in between courses. And I don't like to entertain people whilst they're eating because I wouldn't like somebody entertaining me whilst I was eating.
Well, I understand that completely.
I don't do restaurants anymore.
If you have a large table to entertain, do you perform to everyone from one spot or move around the table?
Again, a very good question. They're fantastic questions, all of these, and thank you, everybody. I do sometimes a bit of both, depending on the circumstance. Sometimes I will do, if it's a round table, I kind of do north, south, east, and west, and then hopefully the people between those areas will get to see what's happening in their group. I don't go around everybody, so I'll do two people at the back, two people at the front, two people at each side, and then hopefully everybody will see it if it's in the round. If there's a lot of furniture on the table, like numbers or big plants, or sometimes I have these big candles in the middle, if they have that, I tend to perform for everybody by doing bigger tricks, like the cop-whacked trick we talked about earlier with the jumbo cards. And I'll do some of the packet tricks which work up here so that people can see me performing like a mini cabaret.
That sounds fantastic. I'm just letting people know we've got about 20 minutes left. So let's get last minute questions in. Daniel also wants to know, I think that's vital. I use a few gimmicks, but always unclean and examinable. Do you have any tips on pocket management, or is it fairly easy with cards?
Well, pocket management, when I go to shows, if I'm not driving, sometimes I go to London on the train. Now, if I go to London on the train, there's nowhere to take a case, because if you work in pubs and clubs or venues, if you leave your case somewhere, the chances are that case will not be there when you come back.
Mm-hmm.
So when I go to London, or and I now do the same wherever I go, I'm wearing my suit, and I have in my outside jacket pocket, I have the corner of Piccadilly we discussed earlier, or one of the other packet tricks. In the outer left jacket pocket, I have a trick of mine called Killer OMG, which is a universal trick. It's very funny. It's got an eye test chart. Look at my website, and you can see a clip of it. I do that one a lot at gigs because it's examinable and it's a stroller. In the little pocket where, in the inside jacket, there's a funny little pocket down the bottom where I keep the ultimate sting, which is a table trick. Again, it's examinable and it's pretty easy to do. Watch the video. In my right-hand pocket, I have the pack of cards. And in my inside jacket pocket, I have some jumbo tricks or jumbo cards. In my right jacket pocket, I have the contract for the gig. And in my back trouser pocket on the left-hand side, I have a spare pack of cards. And in my rear trouser pocket, I have my car keys and some money and train tickets and that kind of stuff, leaving my right trouser pocket free to produce cards from when I do my ambitious card routine or other tricks that use the pocket. So when I go to a gig, I've got like 2 hours on me, 2 hours work on me, and I'm not looking bulgy. I'm not bulging out anywhere. Excuse the expression.
Right. Absolutely. So, you know, it's easy just to go from pocket to pocket. And
I know exactly where I'm going. I don't have to guess where I'm going. I know exactly where everything is, and I just go straight to it.
Another person wanted to know how you handle drunks when you're i.e. hecklers.
Yeah, hecklers. Well, Ian Keeble, fantastic magician, once said to me, I heard him say, rather, if you get heckled, you probably need to get a better act, or you need to be able to perform better, because people normally only heckle if they sense a weakness. So if there's something in your act that is weak, whether it may be the way you walk on, the way you behave, if you look nervous, if you look concerned, if you look worried, hecklers will sense something. So I'll be honest with you, I've never had a heckler really, because I am very confident when I work, and that's not a boast. I'm just telling you, you know, the way I work. I've been doing it a long time, so that doesn't happen to me. But I will avoid working. I won't work for drunks. If they're drunk, I just avoid them and do somebody else. But basically, hecklers are attention seekers, and if they sense a weakness in you, they'll pounce. But if you do get a heckler, ignore him. Don't come back with funny lines, because he'll have a funnier one to come back with. If you have a heckler, ignore him, and the audience, everybody else, will be the people to tell him to go away.
That is very true. It's very true. People that are really wanting to see what's going on and wanting to be entertained will step in and say, shh. I would like to see this. How do you cope with loud music in the background?
Well, I have a contract. It's a one-page contract, which is designed to be one page so it doesn't frighten people with too much information. And apart from the general clauses of payment and cancellation fees, etc., etc., I have two main clauses. Is the artist cannot work in a loud environment, and the artist cannot work outside if cold. So if it's too cold, I can't. My hands kind of clam up, and I can't work. Because in the old days, somebody would invite me for a garden party at 7 o'clock in the evening, no problem. By 9 o'clock in the evening, it's getting cold. So that's that. And if it's too loud, because I'm a patter act, I can't talk loudly over the sound of music. So if there's music and it's loud, I'm out of there.
How did you learn to develop your patter so well? What is there any practice methods? And you had mentioned earlier that you had a lot of one-liners and such. And since we're down to about our last 10 minutes, can you give us some advice on patter?
Well, advice on patter really is that is to listen to your own performance and criticize it yourself a lot, and work out how you want to appear, because, you know, we're all very different. If you're tall and handsome, and there's very few of us around, if you're tall and handsome, you may want to be suave as a performer. If you're short, fat, and hairy, you might want to be comedic. I'm fully aware that when I go out and perform, I look like a manager or something, but then I surprise them by being kind of witty and fast-paced. And it really came out by just working a lot, by working hard, and it evolved. I don't think you can really pick up somebody else's gags and lines and use them effectively. I think you have to find what works for you by just trial and error and working. And I still, even now, I have this book I mentioned earlier. If something comes to me when I'm working and it works, I go home and I write it down.
Write it down in a little black book.
This little piece of business was funny. It worked.
I hadn't thought of making a book out of your little black book.
I haven't because they work for me and they might not work for everybody. And I've got to keep something private, haven't I?
Yeah.
I can't give it all away. If you read the books and the PDF I told you about, the Real Secrets of Card Magic and the Gold Dust books, there's some stuff in there. And on the DVDs, you can see me, with the one-liners and the way I react to people. For instance, there's a funny thing I do when if a girl applauds and laughs and everything else, I say, oh, thank you very much indeed, you've made a very old man happy. I then look to the guy to the left of me and say, you are happy, aren't you? So what's happening there is it's not just a funny line. You're actually involving the guy who then finds that funny. And so you're bringing people into the performance by making them, you're bigging them up. You're noticing them and you're bigging them up so they like to be involved and they feel like you've got a little family thing going on.
That's a cute line. I like that.
What's interesting is when I perform, I don't perform at people. I perform with them. So it's like a joint journey, really. And I do that when I lecture. I lecture to magicians a lot. And when I lecture, I try and say to people, you know, I'm on your side, as it were, and I'm trying to teach you stuff, and I'm lecturing for you and with you, and not at you. I'm not kind of preaching at you.
Yeah, nobody likes to be spoken at. They like to be spoken to.
Yeah.
Well, that's about it for us today.
Oh, that went quickly.
Yeah, it went pretty quick. That was 90 minutes.
Can I say hello to everybody and thank you?
Yes, absolutely. We really, really appreciate you coming by and spending your time with us and giving us your advice and your wisdom.
Oh, that's very kind of you, Laura. Thank you for asking me. That's very sweet of you. It's a pleasure to be here. It really is. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. I don't know how many have tuned in or how many are going to tune in, but to all of you who have done, many, many thanks. Oh, and I've got to paraphrase Frank Sinatra.
Go for it.
May you all live to be 100 years old, and the last card trick you read or try is one of mine. Cheers.
Absolutely. Cheers. I'll cheer you with my coffee here.
And don't forget, folks, look at paulgordon.net. Look at the Gold Dust books. Look at the Real Secrets if you want to know about performing and all the rest of it. Go
yes,
to library.com.
We'll drop a link to the Real Secrets at library.com here for you in a moment.
And don't forget, the Gold Dust books contain the best of everything I've ever done. It's all in here, everything.
Absolutely. Fantastic. It's been wonderful having you.
Bless you. Thank you ever so much, Laurie. You're ever so sweet.
Okay, you have a wonderful evening.
Thanks a lot now. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.